thank you. Welcome as we gather on this second Sunday of Lent. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Welcome. As we gather, I invite you to fill out the registration pads at the end of the pew on the aisle. And if you're visiting with us today, I invite you not only to sign your name there, but to give us some contact information so we can let you know how glad we are that you are with us today. Also, if you have a joy or a concern that you'd like to... Oh, here's Gordon's, okay. They need to replenish this one, maybe. Oh, no, here they are. But you can fill out one of these cards that you see in front of you in the pew, and around the time of the children's moment, we'll ask you to hold those up, and one of the ushers will bring them forward. But you can list on here a joy or a concern that you would like to have lifted in prayer and shared with the congregation. We have a few announcements. First, Carol Stanley.
We have a few very important dates coming up, and I want to make sure that you are aware of them. So first, get on my pops here. It's March the 6th, and if you have children, we are having a wonderful kickoff for our children's program. We need to hear your ideas. There are going to be prizes, tea exchange, cash, the movie theater. It's a big night, 90 minutes. The pasta becomes Chef Jim Grant is cooking us all pasta that night. Flo Mullendor is making pies. And going to watch the nursery, and Bill's playing games with the kids, though he can probably use some help. We invited 30 families. So 90 minutes on Sunday, March 6th, and I'll have a sign up in the social hall. I'm really looking forward to a great night of hearing ideas and suggestions for our program. Next is May 14th and 15th. We are bringing back the church congregational retreat at Big Bear. That was so much fun for many years. We are bringing it back. One night, Big Bear Presbyterian Conference Center, and you get your own room for your family or group of friends. Our theme this year is building a neighborhood together, and we will be building out of cardboard boxes, duct tape, and other materials. So $25 a person, four meals, one night. Really hope that all ages will consider coming if you don't want to spend the night. We may have a daily rate, so let me know if you want to just come over. Great way to meet people of different ages, and it's so much fun. Zip line, rock wall, canoeing, Scrabble, naps, walks, whatever you like. And finally, the final date is June 20th to 24th, and it is Vacation Bible School, Surf, Shack, Catch the Wave of God's Amazing Love. So this is an announcement to families, but it takes about 40 of us to run Vacation Bible School. So if you've never been a part, it is so much fun. Really would encourage you to volunteer for a day or for some preparation, or if there's some way that you can be involved. We've had up to 100, the last few years closer to 70, but we have a lot of children come that week, and just hope that you can be a part of Surf Shack and catch the amazing wave of God's love. So that's what's going on in family and children's ministry.
Thank you. And John Moore.
Well, I hope I'm not preempting Pastor Bill before I make my announcement. I'd like to acknowledge Billy and Harold Weiss were honored last night as Citizens of the Year. Sorry. See her, Billy, but I'm not surprised. Let's just keep on running. And I want to recognize the Bell Choir not only for their participation last night. That was just a beautiful rendition of the PAS show, and I heard Jackie Ivanko singing along right with you. So. Rebuilding Together, Mountain Communities, coming up in a little over 2 months. So we'll have the sign-up sheets available here in the next couple of weeks. Meanwhile, as far as the sponsorship of a house, we're lacking a little bit here in the money. category. We typically raise $1,500 for that. So if you see it in hearts to go ahead and contribute to this year's sponsorship of the home, please just note that on the check we're building together. Thanks, so.
Okay, thank you, John. Yeah, it's our custom, it's our long tradition now of sponsoring a home for rebuilding together. And we're not, I think we have maybe 400 to 500 raised, and we're short that. So, because we're short 1,500. So, please help out as you are led with that. And as John said, indicate on the memo line of the check that it's for rebuilding together. We have a congregational retreat. Yes, we do have a congregational retreat. But next week we have a congregational meeting, and that follows the worship service. So please come and join in that time to hear about things in the life of the church and where things stand financially, as well as hearing other reports about the congregation's life. And John has an announcement.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
All right. So I'm sure you're tired of hearing about it. We're going to hear about it for a few more weeks. Flamingos! They have landed. We are still doing flamingoing. We have quite a few hits in that have yet to be happening. But they will happen soon. So if you have people that you would like a lovely flock of flamingos to land in their front yard, please let us know and we will make it so. Also, starting in the month of March, our youth are going to Trinium, and we are doing fundraising for that through stock sales. The entire month of March, our youth will be selling themselves as stock for this great opportunity to go out and participate in Trinium. What Trinium is a gathering of about 5,000 youth all together in Indianapolis at Purdue University. So it's a great opportunity for our youth. I believe we have 7 going this year. You may hear from one of them a little later today. It's a great opportunity, and they could really use all the help we can get to get them out there. Also, keep your eyes looking out for March, because we are going to have our regular Pi Day sale, 3.14 Pi. It's going to be actually on the 16th, because that's what the Wednesday falls on. But there will be a sale of pies. If you would like to make pies so that you can sell them, that would be great. Again, that will be March 16th. Or if you just like to buy pies or like to have pies, they will be there for your purchase. Thank you so much.
Well, I think that's make a pie so the youth can sell them.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. It's not just a clearinghouse for your baker. Also, this coming Friday is Safe Talk. It is a program that is put on by Room Family Services and our own Marilyn Jordan about helping people in need, primarily emotional need, and helping to understand where people are and what kind of help they might need. Would that be a good
That's pretty. It gives you some tools in your toolbox for yourself, but also friends, relatives. It's just a reaching out. It's a congregational point of view of society.
Okay.
It's no cost, and it's 3 hours, and we have goodies. So please sign up.
Okay, thank you. That's from 6 to 9 on Friday, Friday night. All right, all of that said, yes indeed, John, we're so proud of Billy and Harold Weiss being our citizens of the year in Lake Arrowhead, or the Chamber's selection of citizens of the year. And it was for many of us an honor to be with you last night in that celebration. So. And now let us prepare our hearts and minds to worship God.
I think no culture on earth has more blessings than the Irish. And this last piece that we're going to bring for you has such lovely words, so I want to read them. deep peace of the running wave to you, deep peace of the flowing air to you, deep peace of the quiet earth to you, deep peace of the shining stars to you, deep peace of the gentle night to you, moon and stars pour their healing light on you, deep peace of Christ, the light of the world to you, deep peace to you.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
What a beautiful way to start our service today. Thank you. Thank you very much to the Bellfire and, of course, to God. So please stand if you're able now and join me in the call to worship that's printed in your bulletin. And if you would please remain standing to sing glorious things of thee that are spoken, which is number 446 in your hymn book. The psalmist sings, "One thing I asked of the Lord, that I will seek after,
to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life,
to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in God's temple.
Sisters and brothers, God is good, and love and mercy greets us here."
Let us worship God.
Thank you.
scripture this morning comes from Philippians chapter 3, verses 17 through chapter 4, verse 1, and you can find it on page 198 in the New Testament. Brothers and sisters, join in imitating me and observe those who live according to the example you have in us. For many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. I have often told you of them, and now I tell you even with tears. Their end is destruction. Their God is the belly, and their glory is in their shame. Their minds are set on earthly things. But our citizenship is in heaven, and it is from there that we are expecting a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. He will transform the body of our humiliation, that it may be conformed to the body of his glory, by the power that also enables him to make all things subject to himself. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved.
Well, we just heard in today's scripture the Apostle Paul say, brothers and sisters, join in imitating me and observe those who live according to the example you have in us. Is it possible that we can claim these words as our own and repeat them as our words? Let us take a minute and think about these words and their relevance for our lives as followers of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Merciful God, we hear these words of Paul and know that his life was spent living and proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ, not only to the people of his day, but to people in every age since. He would invite people not only to do as he said, but to do as he did. We are happy to tell others to do as we say, but we want the freedom to do as we choose, even if that means surrendering some of our Christian values. We strive to imitate the lifestyles of the rich and famous and ignore the plight of those who are poor and powerless. We look to others than Jesus Christ as our source of standards. Empower us with the Holy Spirit to deepen our commitment to follow Jesus, even when that means being ridiculed or persecuted or sharing in the struggles and suffering of others. Let us now, in the silence of our hearts, lift our prayers of confession to God. Amen. God, our light and our salvation, does not forsake us or leave us with our sin. In Christ, we are forgiven and offered the healing repentance. Thanks be to God. Please rise now and join in singing the Gloria Patri found in the Lord.
Oh, we can eat on it, right?
But you can
We can roll it. A hockey puck?
Ooh.
Yeah. Or, you know, and with regard to like using it as a plate to eating out, this one could be used as a bowl too, right? Or, what about as, can I sit on it?
It's a chair.
It's a chair?
What?
Oh, yeah. I can break it. I better get off of it. A sled. I hadn't thought about it. A sled. Very good. Well, you know what? I think when I sat in it, what I thought about was it's an offering plate, right? We offer things, and most of the time, you know, money to God when we put it in there. But we can also, you know what we can also give to God? Ourselves. We can sit in the offering plate and give ourselves to God. But we don't do that by sitting in I'm not really just giving myself to God by doing this. Well, maybe. but we give ourselves to God, just like God gave us Jesus and God recalled, and God gives himself to us in Jesus. We give ourselves to God in the ways we do things for other people, in the ways we come to church and worship, in the ways we pray, in the ways we try to make a difference in the world and make things better for other people, because what we're doing by doing that is loving them. Because God loves them and you love them. I could. Yeah, that's true too. Now, let's I was going to say that, but I have a bet. Just quickly, it's everybody sit in it. Not at the same time. Okay, so, let's sit in the offering plate. There you go. Okay. Good job. Very good. Yeah. Oh, I can fit, so you can. Okay. And if later, if any of you want to do that, then send an offering plate. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you that you love us and that you have given yourself to us. And we thank you that you call us to give ourselves back to you. And in many ways to each other. All as ways of being a part of your love and your loving in this world. All this we pray in Jesus' name, and we pray the prayer he taught, amen. And we pray the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen. Thank you, everybody. Please join me in the prayer for illumination that is printed in our bulletin. Lord, open your word by your Holy Spirit, so that we, like Abraham, may believe your promises to us. Amen. Now, our scripture comes from Genesis 15, and this is a pivotal story in the life of the call and the formation of God's people. God has called Abram, who will later be Abraham, called Abram to go with his wife Sarai, who later will be Sarah, and go to the land that God will show. That God will show them. And God promises them land and descendants and to make them a blessing. Indeed, that through their descendants, all the world would be blessed. The gospel according to Matthew begins with the verses, "This is the gospel of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham." And the New Testament's witness is that Jesus is that descendant through whom all the earth will be blessed. But this happens many years after that call had been extended and after the response had happened. And Abram and Sarai have traveled around and had certain adventures. And then it picks up here. "After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abraham said, You have given me no offspring, so I have a slave born in my house to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, Look toward heaven and count the stars, if you are able to count them. He then said to him, So shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. Then he said to him, I am the Lord who brought you from Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. But he said, O Lord God, how am I to know that I shall possess it? He said to him, Bring me a heifer 3 years old, a female goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. Well, he brought him all these things and cut them in two, laying each half over against the other, but he did not cut the birds in two. And when birds of prey came down on the carcasses, Abram drove them away. As the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and a deep and terrifying darkness descended upon him. And then the Lord said to Abram, Know this for certain, that your offspring shall be aliens in a land that is not theirs, and shall be slaves there, and they shall be oppressed for 400 years. But I will bring judgment on the nation that they serve, and afterward they shall come out with great possessions. As for yourself, you shall go to your ancestors in peace. You shall be buried in a good old age. And they came back, and they shall come back here in the fourth generation, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete. When the sun had gone down and it was dark, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passed between these pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, To your descendants I give this land, and from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates, and the land of the Canaanites, the Kenizzites, the Kadamites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Rephaim, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Girgashites, and the Jebusites. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will endure forever. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Eternal God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, a few minutes ago, you heard Stephanie read the Apostle Paul's words to his sisters and brothers in Christ, telling them to stand firm in the faith. But I suspect that many of us have found that standing firm in the faith is sometimes much easier said than done. When life takes surprising turns into fear, into suffering, into loss, when our expectations and longings stall in disappointment, grief, or discouragement, trying to trust the promises of God can become its own challenge and hardship. And so it seems to be with Abram. God has promised to bless him with both land and descendants, and to make him a blessing. Abram need only to set out from his home and his family of origin and go to the land that God will show him. But years later, having done so, Abram is in his late 90s and his wife Sarah crowding 90. And they have no promised land and no child of promise. So when the Lord comes to him, self-identifying as Abram's protection and again promising great blessing, Abram basically says, "Really? If I'm going to have descendants, where's the starter baby? The closest thing I have to an heir is the son of one of my slaves. We are old, and time isn't running out. It's gone. That's it." It might sound familiar to feel as if, well, as if God has let us down or not followed through. Sometimes we might even feel as if we've been set up for disappointment. Was it the child that seemed to be promised but never came? Or was lost at whatever age? It might have been the marriage that ended, or some other relationship, or a love that never came, or plans with loved ones who did not live long enough to live out those plans with us. Or perhaps the dreams, not only of love and loved ones, but of success or career or accomplishments or things that we will never get checked off our bucket list. Sometimes our faith is challenged by the fact that bad things happen to us or to others, or because the good things that we had hoped would happen never did. We often experience these disasters and disappointments as inconsistent with the love and promises of God. As if the Bible says that such things won't happen, or that God will give us everything we want or expect. And so the disasters and disappointments sometimes subvert our faith, because we have found that in the midst of our living, we do experience them. And so we and Abraham to be, call God's faithfulness into question. And understandably so. The Lord walks Abram outside and says, "See those stars? Can't count them, can you? That's how many descendants you will have." And Genesis tells us that Abram believed. Translate that as trusted the Lord.
and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. Our righteousness, our relationship in the Lord, is our trust. Sometimes we think, we believe, we have faith, we have trust, and then God gives us the relationship as the reward for that. That is the relationship that God has given us. But that does not mean that all is sunshine and daffodils. In a dream, the Lord tells Abram that the descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky will be aliens, strangers in a land that is not their own. That means they end up losing the land. And by the way, that's just the first of many times they lose it. And they will become slaves and know oppression in Egypt. And then later, they will be delivered. Sisters and brothers, the God of the Bible never promises that everything will be clear to us, or that tragedy will not strike, or that no one will ever suffer unjustly, or that we will get everything we want, especially when we want it. There are setbacks in life. There is disappointed or delayed expectation. We experience failings and sufferings. But in the midst of that, when we hear the apostles say, stand firm in faith, it's important to remember that our faith, our right relationship with God, is our trust. Trust in the midst of all the things that don't go according to our own sensibilities. And standing firm does not mean that we cease to question or to be afraid or even do some doubting. Standing firm means that we continue the journey with Jesus. For he is our righteousness, and in trusting him, who himself knew pain and suffering and loss and even abandonment and betrayal, he himself is one who calls us to live in his righteousness and live the real promises of God that hold on to the hope even in the midst of the pain and the suffering, even in the midst of the deliverance from it, and even in the midst that it just might come again. To live in the real promise of God is to trust that we can stand firm in the faith and trust, because God is faithful. Amen.
spirit who gives them. There are varieties of ways of serving God, but it is the same Lord who is served. To each is given the gift of the Spirit to be used for the common good. Together we are the body of Christ and individually members of it. Today we ordain an elder in our congregation to the office of elder and install her as well to the session. This congregation has elected Nancy Woolridge as an elder in the Presbyterian Church USA and the Church of Jesus Christ. So Nancy, I put these questions to you. You trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior, acknowledge Him, Lord of all, and Head of the Church, and through Him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Do you?
I do.
Do you accept the Scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be, by the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the Church Universal and God's Word to you? Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? Do you and will you? Will you fulfill your office in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you? Will you be governed by your church's by our church's polity, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them subject to the ordering of God's Word and Spirit? Will you in your own life seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? Will you? Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? Will you seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? And finally, will you be a faithful elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in governing bodies of the church, and in your ministry, will you try to share the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you? And we have these questions from the congregation. Do we, the members of the church, accept Nancy as chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? Do we?
Do
we agree to encourage her, to respect her decisions, and to follow as she and the rest of the session guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is head of the church? Do we? Now I'd like to invite any elders to come forward for the laying on of hands and prayer of installation. And that's not just session members, but anybody who's ordained as an elder in the Presbyterian Church USA, from this congregation or another. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you. We thank you that you call us to faith, and on this day we thank you for your call to faith in the life of Nancy Woolridge. We pray, O God, that you will bless her and keep her and delight her with service to you. We thank you for all who were called, and we thank you and pray your blessing upon her as she answers the call to serve as elder in your church. Grant her a special presence and guidance. May in this experience she grow in wisdom, mature in love, and faithfulness and fruitfulness in service to you. Bless her in collegiality with her colleagues in ministry, and fill us all with your Spirit and delight us with your goodness and your care as agents of love and your justice in this world. All this we pray through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Nancy, you are now an elder in the Church of Jesus Christ and the Presbyterian Church USA. Whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Amen. And we extend the right hands of friendship, or the hugs of friendship and fellowship. Welcome.
Thank you.
acting as Christians in words and in deeds. Christ has given his life for us. Let us offer ourselves and our gifts to him.
Let us continue in prayer to God. Gracious God, we thank you for your care and your love in our lives. In the midst of the difficulties, grant that we may cling to you and hold firm in the faith. Not that we are not shaken, but that we continue the journey. We pray, O God, for all your people. And we pray for people in particular who are all in our hearts and minds. We lift to you Lucy Santos, Gary Gleason, Elizabeth Marr, Jay Vickers, Cindy Gavigan, Kathy Jahelka, Jackie Williford, and Ruth Chastain. Encourage us along the journey of faith, O God, and bless this world and our nation. And we lift to you two Americans who passed away. Thanks for the lives of two Americans who passed away this week, Anthony Scalia and Harper Lee, and their contributions to our society. We lift to you also, O God, the family of Gordon Welsh, whom we have been praying for as Uncle Buzz. And we pray that you will hold him in your care as well and bless his family's tears. All these things we pray, asking that you will stir among us, that you will fill us with your spirit and fill us with a joy and a zeal for your love and your grace and the life that we have with you in Jesus Christ. All this we pray in his name. Amen. Let us stand and sing.
Let us share that peace with one another.